Is there a word from the Lord? Yes, there is a word from the Lord. Get your Bible, your notepad, your pen, your pencil. Let's dig into the word. Sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Well, hello everybody, and welcome once again to this special time in God's Word. I'm so glad to have you with us. My name is Dr. Sheldon D. Newton, coming to you from Jesus Christ Centered Ministries International, located right here in beautiful Nassau, Bahamas. We want to welcome all of you who are listening from Jesus Christ Centered Ministries International, all of our members, all of our partners. We want to welcome all who are listening in New Providence and in the Family Islands of the Bahamas, the Caribbean, listening over there in the United States of America, all of you who are listening in Israel, in China, in Egypt, all of you listening over there in Africa, in England, in Australia, wherever you are, we are glad to have you with us. Shall we pray together? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you and praise you for your word. We ask you in Jesus' name to give us understanding of your word. Give us eyes that we may see, ears that we may hear, and hearts that we may understand. We give you thanks for this now, in Jesus' name. Amen. We are discussing the subject of prayer, developing a deeper life in prayer, and we have already covered some ground along these lines. Now, we are in the initial stages of this teaching, and we're offering you a free study guide and a free PDF copy of my book, Pacific Kinds of Prayer. So if you're interested in getting the free study guide so you could follow along with us, so you can make notes and so forth, and the book, Specific Kinds of Prayer, my brand new book, by the way, a free copy, a free PDF copy of it, you can just write me at sheldond.newton@gmail.com. sheldond.newton@gmail.com, and just say, hey, I'm listening to the broadcast, I'm listening to the program, and I'd like to have that free study guide and that free copy of your book, Specific Kinds of Prayer, and we'll get that right to you. Praise the name of the Lord. We are on chapter 5 in our study guide. We have already covered why pray, what is prayer, and we've already gone through concerning reasons for praying, how we have access to the very throne of God now, something that the old covenant saints did not have. As a matter of fact, if you remember when God gave the temple, only the high priest was permitted once a year to go into the Holy of Holies, into the very presence of God. But under this new covenant, through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are able, every child of God, I don't care how young or how old, every child of God is able to come boldly to the throne of grace to receive help and receive mercy and find help in time of need, according to Hebrews 4 and verse number 16. We have last week started to cover ingredients for answered prayer, and we were speaking of the two specific ingredients that the Master gave. He gave them in John the 15th chapter and the 7th verse, where it says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you. Now, again, a lot of times when I hear that quoted, people say, and my word. But Jesus didn't say my word. He said, my words abide in you. He said, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. God's word covers all we need for life and godliness. All of the promises of God cover every area of our lives. And we need the knowledge of the word so that we can have faith to believe God for what we're praying about. All right? So, I said to you, and of course what I just quoted is 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. But you have to understand that God is a faith God. And what I mean by that is, he loves when we believe him. He loves and gets pleasure out of us believing him. Someone has said God's greatest pleasure is to be believed. In other words, he gets a kick out of when we believe what he has said. You know, I think it would be really a bad thing if a parent does not get a joy out of knowing that if he promises or she promises their child something, their child knows that that's a settled deal. If mommy or daddy said it, that's done. Well, God gets a kick out of stuff like that. He gets a kick when we hold him to his word and when we say, Father, this is what you promised, and we're coming on the basis of this promise. And God, the Bible says he remembers his covenant. So God says, well, I promise it, therefore I will do it. All right? Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, live in you, dwell in you, remain in you, he said, you shall ask what you will. Wow. And it shall be done unto you. What a glorious promise. Amen. And so the two ingredients to answered prayer Jesus gave in John the 15th chapter and the 7th verse is we must abide in him. And if you're born again, we are in Christ. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. When we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior, Jesus comes to live in us, but the Holy Spirit also baptizes us into him, into his body, to be a part of his body. We are now parts of the body of Christ, all right? So we are in him. But we must abide in him. We must stay in him. Now, how do you do that? You do that simply by walking with him. You know, spending time in his presence, spending time in his word. Walking with him in obedience, trusting him. You know, a day-by-day process. Glory to God. A day-by-day process. And, you know, of course, along the way, you may stumble, you may fall. But you get back up, you ask God to forgive you in Jesus' name, according to 1 John 1:9. And then you walk on. With the Lord. But we must abide in him. That's one of the ingredients for answered prayer. And then the second step is, and I believe this is where many are missing it in the prayer life. His words must abide in us. His words must abide in us. Now, we've already read this, but I feel it is so, so important that I want to read a statement that I've written here again. We must develop a healthy respect for God's word. It is praying the word and praying in line with the word that brings results. God has exalted his word above all his name and has given the promise that no word from him will return to him void. We return his word back to him in prayer. He then moves by his spirit and answers our prayers because we are acting in faith on his promises. All right? So we need to be people who dwell in the word. And we've already talked to you concerning how to have the word abide in you. If you didn't listen to that, it is still up on YouTube. Go back and listen to last week's teaching and you'll be able to find out according to Proverbs 4, which is 20-22, how to get the word of God to abide in you richly by attending to God's word, by inclining your ear to his sayings, by not letting him depart from your heart and from your eye, from your mouth, and by practicing the word, you see? He said, my son, attend to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Let them not depart from your eyes. You got to keep them before your eyes. And then he said, let them not depart from their eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart. Keep them in the midst of your heart. How? By attending to them, by inclining your ear to them, and by not letting them depart from your eyes. Why? For they are life. They are life unto those that find them, and they are medicine to all our flesh. Now, let's look at the bottom of, I believe, which page is this here? In the study guide, page 9, at this principle of prayer. This is a principle of prayer. How do we let his words abide in us continually? We attend to his word, we incline our ear to his sayings, we read God's word daily, we study God's word, and we meditate in God's word. Here's the principle of prayer now. The principle for successful or answered prayer. Find scripture which covers and promises what you are asking for, and feed upon the word in that area, building your faith to believe God for what you need or desire. Let me read that again. I pray that you really, really pay attention to this. Find scripture which promises, which covers and promises what you are asking for and feed upon the word in that area, building your faith to believe God for what you need or desire. Feed upon the word until that word becomes alive in you in that specific area that you are believing God for. If it's healing, go and find the scriptures in the Bible that guarantee your healing. Don't be lazy. Don't say, oh, and I already know by His stripes I was healed. Go and find the scriptures and attend to God's word. Incline your ear to it. Let them not depart from your eyes. And listen, again, I want to emphasize how easy the internet has made this. I mean, when we were growing up as Christians over 30 plus years ago, we did not have it this easy. We had to go and find out a lot of things for ourselves by feeding from others and by getting in the word. But listen, you can go right on YouTube and put in healing scriptures and someone will come there up on there reading the healing scriptures to you. And you can take that and you can download that and you can let that word on healing just play and play and play and play and play and play. And listen, I'm telling you, there's been a report and a person who took the word of God just like the Bible said, because you remember now what I quoted from Proverbs 4. It said, His word is medicine to all your flesh. I don't care what sickness, I don't care what disease the devil tries to throw at you. If you get enough of God's healing word in you, enough of God's medicine in you, that'll drive that sickness or that disease completely out of your body. Did you hear me? If you get enough of God's word in you regarding healing and feed on it and feed on it and feed on it until the Holy Spirit is able to make the truth alive in you that Jesus really did take your infirmities and that Jesus really did bear your sicknesses and that by His stripes you were healed. When that comes alive on the inside of you, that'll drive that sickness, that disease right out of your body. Amen. I said amen. Glory to God. There's healing power in the word of God. The Bible says in the book of Psalm 107 verse 20, He sent His word and healed them and delivered them from their troubles or their destruction. Listen to me. Whatever area you are dealing with, go and find the scriptures in the word that covers your case and feed on them. Feed on them. Feed on them until the Holy Spirit makes the word in that area alive on the inside of you. Amen. And when He does, my brother and sister, watch out. You'll be able to pray in faith. You'll be able to pray with confidence and with assurance that God has heard your prayer and that He has answered. You'll be able to walk with a level of expectancy and with a level of divine persuasion that hell itself cannot take away from you. It is interesting to me that the greatest challenge of the child of God, of many believers, is the challenge of staying in the word. The devil fights believers tooth and toenail to keep them with the intention of keeping them away from the word of God. And listen to me, the word of God is our spiritual food. It is our spiritual strength. And if you don't get in the word of God and feed on the word of God, when you try to pray and believe God for things, you're going to find it very difficult to believe Him, all because that word is not abiding in you, living in you, alive in you, and keeping your attention I'm at full force. And so I encourage you, because I've noticed, people will always tell you, I need you to pray for me. And you say, okay, what are we praying for? Okay, what scripture are you standing on? Now, you may say, like someone did, well, nothing in particular. Well, that's just exactly what you'll get. You'll get nothing in particular, all right? Because you don't have no faith to believe God for what you're praying about. You need to build your faith. You say, well, do I have to have faith? Well, that's just the way God operates, all right? Hebrews 11 and verse 6, without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he that comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that seek Him. Listen, God is looking for someone who believes Him. And it might as well be me. It might as well be you. He is looking for someone who believes Him so that He can show Himself strong on our behalf. All right? And so Feed on the word, whichever area. If it ain't healing, it may be that you have a need that needs to be met. Go find out what the Bible has to say. Go feed on that word until that word comes alive on the inside of you. And when that word comes alive on the inside of you, now it's time to pray. Why? Because now you can pray with confidence because you know what God said. You see? And again, this covers every area of life. What does the word say? All right? Now, notice this statement again, and then we're going to get into specific kinds of prayer. Notice here. Find scripture which covers and promises what you are asking for, and feed upon the word in that area, building your faith. As you feed on that word, you're giving the Holy Spirit the opportunity to make that word alive in you. So it will ignite or build your faith to believe God for what you need or desire. Hallelujah. Now, let's go to the next chapter. This is in chapter 6 of the study guide on specific kinds of prayer as we look at a deeper life in prayer. We want to cover the fact that there are different kinds of prayer. Just as there are different sporting events, all dealing with balls, a different kind of a ball, basketball, football, soccer ball, you know, golf ball, tennis ball. There are just different kinds of sports that deal with the different kinds of balls. And each of those different sports have different rules. Think about that now. Basketball and football are not played with the same rules. Volleyball and football are not played with the same rules, you see? Just as these different sports, all of them have to do with playing a ball, but there are also different rules that go with these different sports. Likewise, there are different kinds of prayer. There are different kinds of prayer in the Word of God. And those different kinds of prayer are governed by different kinds of rules. I think, again, a lot of times we just put all of it together, pray all the different kinds of prayer in one go, drop them all together and hope that something stick, hope that something get God's attention, you know? But we can pray and believe God on a much better method than hit and miss, all right? And so God has given us in the Word various kinds of prayer, and those various kinds of prayer address the various needs that we have in our lives, all right? And so Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 18, if you look there a moment, Paul the apostle said, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all manner, perseverance for all saints. The Amplified Bible says praying with all manner of entreaty and prayer. All right. Another translation is said to say praying always with all kinds of prayer. In other words, there's more than one kind of prayer given in the Word of God. Well, let's look specifically at some of them. In the study guide, it lists some of them from A to J. Glory to God. From A to J, but it lists some of them for us. First, there is the prayer of worship, praise, and thanksgiving. Or another term for that is ministering to the Lord. Now, read these Bible references for yourself, please. Make sure you make time to read them for yourself. Get your Bible out and you know, if you have to, dust your Bible off. Dust it off and read these scriptures for yourself, all right? Ministering to the Lord, Acts 13, verse 2 and 3. And I'm only going to talk about that one for a moment here. It says that there were five men who were before the Lord. And the Bible said they were fasting and they were ministering to the Lord. These men were not there asking about God, asking the Lord to meet their needs. They were not there asking the Lord to do this or to do that. They were there just to worship Him. Whoa, glory to God. Have you ever had a time like that? Have you ever had a time where you go into the presence of God and say, Father, I'm not coming to ask you for any specific thing. I just want to come and spend some time around the throne. I just want to come and worship you a while. I just want to come and praise you and bless you and thank you and glorify you because of how good you are and how kind you are and how wonderful you are. Whew, glory to God. It's something about that kind of meeting with God that causes the Father to be pleased. As a matter of fact, in Acts 13, verse 2 and 3, as they were there just worshiping and ministering to the Lord, the Bible said, in that atmosphere, the Holy Spirit spoke and said, "Separate unto me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I've called them." Barnabas and Saul were set apart to the apostolic office while they were worshiping the Lord. All right? And so that's one way to pray, just to come before him and listen. Whew, basoto ramasa. Let me tell you something. That's one of the greatest ways to draw closer to the Lord, to just worship him, to spend time in his presence, just giving him glory, honor, worshiping him, magnifying Jesus, telling Jesus how wonderful he is, telling him how glorious he is, just worshiping the Father God. And by the way, let your worship be for real, okay? Don't just worship God, throwing all kind of empty, "Oh, I love you and praise you." No, let every word you say to him come from your heart. Let every word you say to him have meaning, all right? But that's the first kind of prayer that we're talking about here, the prayer of ministering to the Lord. Oh, glory be to God. I can even sense his presence as we talked about this kind of prayer. It is just a glorious thing to spend time in the Father's presence giving him glory. He loves that. Praise the Lord. He loves that. Then, and we're going to talk about this specific kind of prayer in more detail next week, the prayer of faith. And of course, you see Matthew 21 there, verses 18 to 22, and Mark 11, the classic scripture on faith, Mark 11, verses 22 to 26. And of course, we'll talk about that. That's where Jesus said in verse 24, "Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them." Well, many people went off the wire, but when they heard, "What things soever you desire," and they start desiring other people's things. Well, that's covetousness. That he was not saying to desire other people's things or other people's spouse. All right? When he said, "What things have you desire," he's talking about things that are in line with the Word of God. All right? But we're going to talk specifically about that kind of prayer next week, because there are many people who do not understand how to pray in faith, and we're going to address that. And then there's the prayer of consecration to the will of God. Now, let me tell you something. This really is one of the only times, there is another prayer about this there, but this really is one of the only times when you really pray those words, "If it be thy will." In the prayer of consecration, you're committing yourself to the will, the plan, and the purpose of God. Some of it you simply may not know. Some of it, you know, God don't reveal everything to us. I mean, so, you know, I don't know what all his plans are for me in the future. So when I pray, I say, "Father, I consecrate myself to your will. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. I'll say what you want me to say." And I consecrate and dedicate myself to the Lord, to the service of God, you see. And so when you talk about the consecration, what you're talking about is giving yourself over to his will. And you're saying, "Father, if you don't want me to do so-and-so, I won't do it. Or if you want me to do so-and-so, I will. Even though I may not feel like doing it, Father, if it be your will, I'll do it." You see? And that's the prayer the Lord Jesus Christ prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he knew the suffering that he was about to experience. The greatest of the suffering was that he would be separated from the Father for a period of time, you see. And so that in itself to him was, I mean, a touch of great touch of soul. And he said to the Father, he said, "Not my will," he said, "but your will be done," you see. And so he took our sins upon himself, and the Father had to abandon him for a time, and he did that for us. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And then we have the prayer of agreement, Matthew 18, verses 19 and 20. We'll talk about that too when we probably go talking about the prayer of faith next week, because a lot of times people try to get people to agree with them in prayer who don't agree with them, you know. So we need to make sure that when we ask someone to agree with us in prayer, we're both on the same page. We're going to talk about that. And then there's the prayer of casting your cares upon the Lord. You can find scripture for that in Philippians 4, verse 6 and 7, and in the book of 1 Peter 5 and 7. And I love both of those renderings from the Amplified Classic edition. And so I encourage you to read them over, and we may get into tapping into a little bit of that, because I've prayed these various kinds of prayers through the years, and I've seen and received the results of praying these various kinds of prayer. And so these prayers work. God's word works, all right? And these kinds of prayer work. All you have to do is fulfill the conditions or the requirements given in the various kinds of prayer. Fulfill the requirements, the principles, all right? And then, of course, there is the prayer of casting your cares, like I said, upon the Lord. I wanted to give you that verse, 1 Peter 5 and 7, Amplified Bible, says, casting the whole of your care, all your worries, all your concerns, all your anxieties once and for all on him, for he cared for you affectionately and he cares about you watchfully. All right, that's the Amplified Bible Classic Edition. The King James Version says, casting all your care upon him, for he cared for you. Do you know it's a sin to worry? It's a sin to worry. All right, well, what am I going to do if I don't worry? Cast your care on God. Give him your cares. All right? But he doesn't want you, as a child of God, worrying about anything. In the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verse 6, Philippians 4, 6, he said, do not fret, the Amplified Bible now, do not fret or have anxiety about anything. One time ago, the King James says, be careful for nothing. One time ago, you know, when you talk to people, sometimes a person may say, be careful for nothing. And they thought, I guess, that they were quoting that scripture. But when it said, be careful for nothing, the word careful there means anxious or worried. You see? So he's saying, do not fret or have any anxiety about anything. God don't want you worrying about nothing. Some people worry so much that they worry when they don't have nothing to worry about. They're worrying about why I don't have nothing to worry about. But listen, child of God, you're a child of God. You're a child of the creator of the universe. And the Father God doesn't want his children worrying about anything. All right? He wants you to live in the peace of God. Live in the rest of God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Then you have the prayer of supplication or humble petition. And we'll look at that. That's Ephesians 6:18. We'll probably take a good look at that next week as well. We'll see how it goes. Then there's the call for help. Now, this is the kind of prayer where I don't know if you've ever been there, but I've been to the place where I didn't know what else to pray. I didn't know what else to say. And I just had to say the one thing I think it's the Syrophoenician woman in the book of Matthew 15. She went to the master, and because her daughter had a demon, and she went to the master to cast that demon out. And the Lord Jesus said, "Listen, I'm only sent to the Jews at this time." And she said, and she worshipped him and said, "Help me." And let me tell you something. There's something about the call for help. The Bible says in the book of Psalm 46 and 1, he is a very present help in trouble. God is a very present help in trouble. And I don't know about you, but I've reached those places where there were times when I just had to say, help me. Amen. And he helped me. He helped me. Glory to God. He helped me. All right? So there's the call for help. And I have your references there for you. And then there is the prayer of intercession. Now, we're going to cover that, and we're going to give the prayer of intercession its own lesson, because there's so much to say about intercessory prayer. There are many people who are used in intercessory prayer. Some of them are having experiences that they don't really understand. Some of them end up going off the path that they should go, because they start to actually enter into places, I won't say in the spirit, meaning in the Holy Spirit, but they start to more or less get drawn away over into extremes and fanaticism by evil spirits who are trying to distract them from the real purpose of prayer. All right? And so there are people who have gone off into all kind of things to try and more or less show that they're deep, or to show that they are. And I'm not criticizing. Please don't think that way at all. I'm not criticizing. What I'm getting at is, if the enemy can pull us away from our core purpose, if he can pull us away from our objective and start to get us to think that, you're now elevated, and you're now deeper than this one, and you're now deeper than your pastor, and now you know more than your pastor, and all of that kind of stuff, and pump you up with a bunch of pride, it's not going to work out in your favor, all right? Intercessory prayer is a selfless act of praying for other people. It's a selfless act of praying for other people and praying other people through without attempting to get any glory for yourself. All right? And so we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about different kinds of intercession, because there are various kinds of intercession. And we're going to get into some details along that line. We're going to talk about groanings in the spirit. We're going to talk about travail in the spirit. And so we're going to talk about when the Holy Spirit comes upon you in intercession and moves you over into the spirit realm through intercession, to deal with specific things and to deal with specific matters. Intercession can be done for an individual, can be done for a nation, can be done for a group of people, can be done for the world. But we'll talk about that, all right? And then there's another area here, prayer and fasting. And this is in Isaiah 58, which is 1 to 14, Matthew 17, 14 to 21. And we'll talk about prayer and fasting as well, because if there was ever a time when the people needed to seek the face of God, really regarding things that are going on, regarding what is going on right now in the world, and regarding the purpose and plan of God, it is now. Let me tell you something, and you better listen to me now. The world is right now in a situation, and I didn't say our country, I said the world. The world is right now in a situation where their hands are tied and really they don't know what to do. This coronavirus thing, a pandemic, has caused a lot of people to become afraid, to panic, to resort to all kinds of things, and I'm being honest with you. The world system, governments, and so forth, they really have little to no idea of what they are really doing. We need to seek the face of God. We need to get our answers from the throne. And we need to know what the Lord is saying. I know much in this particular climate, many have gone to reading after this and reading after that, and you know, listening to this one and listening to that one and listening to this talk show and listening to that talk show. Everybody has an opinion of what should be done and so forth. But I'm telling you, child of God, more than ever before, we need to seek the face of God. We need to trust in the Lord with all our hearts and lean not to our own understanding. We need to acknowledge him in all our ways, according to Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6, and we need to let him direct our paths. We need to mark those verses in our Bible and refer to them and practice it, because I'm telling you, the world right now is in a state of panic. The world right now is in thick darkness. The world right now is not knowing what to do. And I'm telling you, children of God, that we need to seek our Father's face and let him direct our paths, all right? And so I encourage you to, when we do the lesson on prayer and fasting, and I don't know if I remembered putting that in the study guide here, but we are going to talk some about fasting and prayer. We'll probably cover that in chapter 10 when we deal with consecration to the will of God, all right? But we will at some point deal with that, because it is so necessary. The longer we go, the more I'm sensing that pull, that tug of the spirit to give myself more to consecration to the will of God, and to hear the mind of the spirit in this day and in this hour. And so I believe God is calling his people in the midst of all of what's going on. God is calling his people more than ever to fasting and to prayer and to listening to him, and not a fasting and prayer so people will think we're deep or we're this or we're that. I'm just talking about times of seeking him, asking God to direct us, to lead us, to guide us, to instruct us, to show us what's going on, and to give us a word in due season that we may be able to minister to other people. And so hopefully we'll get into that. And then the last kind of prayer I have here, we'll talk about this as well, is called communion prayer, the prayer of drawing near to God. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, we're going to talk about that as well. Well, whether you believe it or not, our time is just about gone. And listen, there are other kinds of prayer in the Word of God, all right? I'm just listing some here for you. I'm hoping that these would minister to you. Remember, if you have not received the study guide just yet, please go ahead and email me at SheldonD.Newton@gmail.com, and I will get, say, Bishop, I'm listening to you, and I want that study guide, and I'll send that out to you. I'll email it to you, as well as email you the PDF copy of my book, Specific Kinds of Prayer. Listen, God bless you till we get around his word again. And if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, just simply pray and say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart, be my Lord, be my Savior. I'll live for you from this day, in Jesus' name, amen. We're so glad you've joined us for this broadcast today, and we trust that the Word of God has made an impact upon your life that will never be erased. Hey, listen, if you enjoyed this word from the Lord, please subscribe to this channel so that you don't miss out on other teachings of the Word of God that we put forward. Also, if you have any prayer requests, we'd love to stand in agreement in prayer with you. Listen, God still answers prayer. So if you have any prayer requests, please email us at the email address on the screen and let us know. We want to be praying for you. Until we meet again around the Word of God, remember, Jesus Christ is Lord and divine love flows.